Good
afternoon, members. Happy Valentine's Day. I hope we can conclude our meeting timely so that we can all go and celebrate Valentine's Day. Quorum has been four. I now call the meeting to order. First item, confirmation of minutes. Any comments? No? Minutes confirmed. Information papers issued since the last meeting. There are three papers. They are all related to fake rice. And we have got a response from the administration. There's a response to Dr. Honorable Chiang Lai-wan's letter. And they have taken some samples for tests, for chemical tests. And those were found to be genuine rice, but we haven't seen any report. I think the Secretariat should remind the government to upload the lab certificate to their website, so to tell us what they found as a matter of enhancing transparency. So if members wish to bring this subject up for discussion again, we'll do it later. The third paper, administration's information paper on the cooperation agreement between Hong Kong and Shenzhen on the inspection and quarantine arrangement at Chiang Hai. I think it was raised by a member. I think it's Dr. Kwok Kar Kai. It's about frozen meat. And that before importation, frozen meat will be transported to Chiang Hai for storage before the entering Hong Kong. Do we need to have a discussion? But so far, no importer of frozen meat has done that, and that is no one has stored frozen meat in Chiang Hai under Chiang Hai under the arrangement. Items for discussion for the next meeting, please refer to the list of outstanding items. The next meeting will be held on the 14th of March. It's a Tuesday. We'll start at 2:30 p.m. Three items have been proposed. One, the first one is proposed by our members, i.e. regulating the production of organic food, the definition, and how do we regulate the production of such food. It's item one on the list of outstanding items. On the side of the government, two items have been proposed for our discussion. First, rodent prevention and control measures, and that is number two on the list of outstanding items. And another sub item is a public market stores rental up to 30th of June 2017. That is item number three on the list of outstanding items. So three items for the next meeting. Dr. Angel, you want to say something? Yes, indeed, Madam Chair. In respect of rodent prevention, we'd like to have more information on specific policies. You and I both belong to Kowloon West constituency, which is an old district with more serious rodent problems. So you want to talk about policies. Well, I want to have specifics rather than what should be done, what we have done, and so on and so forth. It's not really about talking about the problem. We want to have more specific information.
Well, the rodents don't just thrive in Kowloon West. They go all over. So we'll discuss the relevant policy. Now, if there are no special questions, then we come to the agenda for discussion. We have three items. So we have a tight schedule. The first, biosecurity measures implemented in local chicken farms. And we like to ask the secretary to invite the officials in. This will take us to about 10 after 3. Then The other second item will be the report on the food surveillance program for 2016, and then it will be the implementation of the nutrition labeling scheme. Now we welcome the officials for this item. Professor Sophia Chen, Undersecretary for Food and Health, Mr. Bill Wong, Principal Assistant Secretary for Food and Health, Dr. Thomas Sid, Assistant Director, AFCD, and Ms. Wing Yao, Assistant Secretary for Food and Health, and also Dr. Shirley Veronica Chok, Senior Veteran Officer of AFCD. Now, we first invite professors to brief us on the document. Now, this document is about the biosecurity measures on local chicken farms. Now, we all know that this flu case, avian flu outbreak has been active, and the government has adopted a series of monitoring and control measures. So we like to tell you about the measures taken at local chicken farms. Now, the number of such farms has reduced to about 29 at present, and the government has limited the total population to about 1.3 million chicken, and there is also a steady supply to meet the market demand for live chickens. And also the government has implemented a mandatory vaccination for local chicken farms, and in 2012 all local chicken farms have to register for our six vaccine against the H5N2 vaccine, but with the appearance of H5N6, then starting in November last year, we introduced from the Harbin Veterinary Research Institute the R6 and R8 vaccines and apart from H5 there's also H7. So according to World HO, there has to be close monitoring, and the government has been testing for the H7 virus on local chicken farms, and the AFCD has been monitoring closely and has been studying the possibility of introducing further new vaccines, and all local poultry farms have to meet with relevant requirements for biosecurity, including installing anti-bird nets, installing separate entrances and the separation measures and so on. And the FCD staff inspect the local chicken farms at least once a week to ensure health conditions are met, and the FCD also regularly analyze the swab samples and so on. And it's only through the avian flu tests, after the tests are done, can the chicken be dispatched to the market. And since 1997, we have never suffered any case of local transmission, human transmission of avian flu. Nevertheless, given the risk of AI in Hong Kong and in neighboring areas, we have to stay vigilant, and we have to continue. The document is quite lengthy, so there's no need to read it all. Perhaps you can highlight the new measures. The new measures are mainly that since November last year, we have adopted the bivalent R6 plus R8 vaccines since November last year, which cover the H5N1 and H5N6 and all the clades concerned. So there are new vaccines to be injected. Yes, we started this in November last year. And what's the current vaccine called? Now this vaccine is RE6 plus RE8. It's a bivalent vaccine. So there's a new vaccine. So how many members wish to ask questions? Ho Chun Yin, Lau Kwok Fan, Kwok Ka Ki, and Chang, and I are going to ask questions. Any other? If not, four minutes, including answers. First, Mr. Ho Chun Yin. Well, I am usually the first to speak about chicken. Now, first, we thank the administration for its efforts over the years. Of course, in the process, there have been different opinions on the government's efforts. Some say that the measures are very stringent. And since 2008, our local farms have never given rise to AI. And in the recent outbreak, thousands have been culled in other parts of the world, but we've been safe so far in Hong Kong. So we still meet challenges. We hope the government would pay attention. Now there's the RE6 plus RE8 vaccine. Now the farms have been receptive. They think that the live chicken have become more lively and it's good for the environment. And the imported vaccines are from Harbin. Now we keep importing vaccines, but still we may lag behind other places. So we hope that we can have local R&D and manufacture. Now there's a veterinary department at CTU. Maybe the government can cooperate with CTU so that we can stay ahead of any mutation in the viruses. Now, if we do R&D locally, then we can test the vaccines early. It would be good for our chicken farms. Also, there are various restrictions on the chicken farms. We cannot improve the environment of the chicken farms. We can do only minor maintenance. And the relocation requirements are also very strict. Perhaps the government can amend the regulations so that the poultry farms and the pig farms can suitably relocate. Now, in particular, the requirements are very strict for pigs. Also, the live chicken wholesale outlets. Now, at the time that there it was a provisional measure due to the circumstances. And now, should there be relocation? Should there be enhancement? But the government departments never try to find new locations for us. The government merely tries to find land for housing. So it's not just the live poultry, also the vegetable markets, the fish markets, all these should be received in attention from the government. I will invite Dr. Sid to answer the first question. I understand that Mr. Ho wishes there can be more local R&D. It takes time to come up with new vaccines, and imported vaccines have to be registered first. So, Dr. Sid, can there be local R&D concerning AI vaccines? Why do we use the Harbin Research Institute vaccines? Because it's stipulated by the World Health Organization as a responsible institute, and the country and the government, the Chinese government, has also invested a lot in in this institution. So now the vaccine is good for the whole country, so for the whole region. So the vaccines, if it merely protects Hong Kong, then we cannot catch up with the mutation in the vaccines in the region. So we don't just work with a particular university, we have to keep up with the changes in the whole region and in entire Asia. And the nationally appointed research institute is keeping up. It's responding very nimbly, and we when the development is such that we need to migrate to a new vaccine, we can do so through this arrangement. Now, in some provinces in China, there is still H5N6, so we need to have a vaccine that handles both H5N1 and H5N6 until one of them has disappeared. Now, we do work with universities, including local universities like CTU, whom we will closely cooperate with. Time is up on wholesale markets. Now, we had such a discussion. There will be also a report on live chicken, so there will be time for discussion. Next, Lau Kwok Fun. Looking at the H7N9 outbreak in Guangdong, it's quite serious, over 300 cases. I'd like to learn about the mutual reporting and goalkeeping efforts right now. We all along have a mutual information mechanism with the mainland. We have the Center for Food Safety and the other departments concerned all along have been keeping abreast of the AI situation on the mainland, the number of people affected, and so on. Now, on the number of chicken culled and where they were found, the AFCD also maintains close contact with them. As soon as we notice a serious development in neighboring countries, we would be well prepared.
As we set out in the paper, apart from vaccination, there are other measures such as monitor surveillance measures, cleansing measures, guidelines for the practitioners to ensure local security. And we also pay attention to imported cases. And if there's something untoward, we would notify each other under the system. Have we stopped the importation? You mean from the mainland? Well, we have not stopped that. We have never stopped importation from the mainland. But there are only a small number of chicken imported from the mainland. But the We have imported much fewer chicken, but there are other poultry imported. We note the views of the importers of mainland chickens. We have talked to these parties on various occasions, and our permanent secretary visited Beijing a number of times to talk about the importation of live chicken from the mainland. A few rounds of discussion were held, but since this is a commercial operation, we are seeing much less lower level of importation right at present. Do you have figures? As Professor Chen has said, we're talking about mainly the importation of other poultry, such as peasants. The total number is 600,000 as for chicken. Well, it's based on commercial considerations. We're not seeing a lot. Are you going to step up sampled testing? The CFS has been taking samples for surveillance tests. In respect of miscellaneous poultry, they would carry out the necessary inspection and quarantine measures. For every batch, they would take do some quick tests for H5 and H7, and there will also be a serology test to see if there's antibody, H5 antibody in chicken. It's part of the surveillance program by the CFS. Mr. Wong, there was a question about importation of live chicken from the mainland. So it's not that we have stopped importation, but is it true that after February last year, no chicken has been imported? That's correct, apart from some other types of poultry, such as pheasants and quails. Dr. Kwokake, we have very few locally contracted AI cases, but we have some imported cases, in particular H7N9 in Guangdong. There are some cases, and there's H5 case in Macau. If the local chicken population is sufficient to meet local demand, and on the other hand, the importation from Guangdong poses such a high risk, why don't we stop the importation until the risk is lower? According to you, we have a total population of 1.3 million chickens, and that should be sufficient for local demand. And if our local farms are safe and there are no history of AI outbreak, shouldn't we encourage suitable farms with a good track record to increase the supply levels so that we can reduce the risk to the lowest possible levels? Because we're not talking about risk posed by local farms, but by Guangdong. So if we have a local capacity to meet local needs, then we don't need to be concerned about importation. The bivalent vaccine was introduced last year, but then on the mainland, especially in Guangdong, the number of outbreak has not been reduced. Is it because of the short trial out period for this new vaccine? Maybe Dr. Sid can explain why, given this new vaccine, that they still have a problem with outbreaks. And for as for H7N9, we have heard from certain reports that certain markers were found to be in operation despite the prohibition. I don't know what more can be done with Guangdong province. To prevent people from bringing chickens into Hong Kong, because if there's an imported case in Hong Kong, our local chicken industry will be seriously affected. So, altogether, three questions. Thank you, Dr. Kwok. I will take the third one, and I will defer to Dr. Sid for the first two questions. Yes, we have heard, we have learned from reports that in some parts of the mainland, there may be illegally slaughtered chickens, starting from February last year. We have not been importing any chickens from the mainland apart from assorted poultry, and these are come from registered farms destined for Hong Kong market. And we also carry out tests at Meng Kam Tow, the Bong boundary control points. And if there's a problem, the imported poultry will be stopped. Dr. Sid, please respond to the first two questions. Well, starting from the 8th of February 1998, when we resumed the importation of chickens from the mainland, we have reached a farm an agreement with the Inspection and Quarantine Authority on the mainland that the registration and the inspection will be on a registered farm basis. Every farm before exporting chickens we'll have to do some tests, and then the batch of chickens will be certified to be okay by their vets, and then if the test at Meng Kam Tow also shows that they're okay. Well, although the mainland has never declared it itself as a AI infected area, but they sort of admit that this has become an endemic problem. So they have been doing things in accordance with international practice. Why? And the other question is why do we still have H5N7 or H5N8 in neighboring countries? Well, most of the cases can be found in Korea and Taiwan because they have this policy of no vaccination. So if there's an imported case there, they will have a serious outbreak and they have to cull chickens. They have to carry out culling exercises. And according to media reports, most cases, there are more H5N9 cases on the mainland. Not that there have not been any H5N7 cases. For the so-called yellow chickens, they will be consumed within 9 days. And there will be two rounds of vaccination, 10 odd days and 40 odd days, and sufficient antibodies will be produced through the vaccination. As for waterfowls, they will be kept at a pond. And if the virus is present, it's difficult to disinfect the entire pond. When the ducklings are born, the virus will already be on the ducklings. And then after 10 odd days, the vaccine is given, and it's not effective vaccination. Although the vaccine is effective, but the environment factor prevents the vaccine from taking effect. Please clarify this. Please make it clear. Ms. Anne Chiang, Madam Chair. Although we are not importing a lot of mainland chickens, and these chickens will go to Chiang Sha Wan first, and there are many residential buildings there, and more are being built, and we were told that another site will be identified for relocation, but nothing has been achieved on that front. I know it's difficult to find a new site, but do you have a plan? Are we going to ban the importation of live poultry in 2 or 3 years? If that's the case, there will be no need to find a new site. Otherwise, you have to seriously consider what we should do in the future. And to follow up on Dr. Kwokake's questions, although we are not importing a lot of live chickens, but there are people bringing in cooked chickens, but they are not fully cooked. You can still find blood on such chickens. And they will bring these half-cooked chickens into Hong Kong for the resale locally. So you have to pay attention to this. We have heard that there are many AI cases on the mainland, and we have heard about a number of confirmed cases. And also the Consumer Council has carried out tests on local chickens samples, and they found ESBL is a germ which is resistant to antibiotics. And if such chicken is not cooked fully and is consumed, it can be it can lead to the health problems or poisoning, food poisoning. Let me talk about the relocation plan for Chiang Sha Wan market. We are aware of the local aspirations, but it's difficult to find a new site. The site has to be suitable in that there can be biosecurity measures properly implemented there. But there's the question of local objection of local residents. So we have not been able to identify a site so far. But there's also a consultancy report saying that in the long run, we should consider whether live chickens should be allowed to be made available on the market. And then we are going to come back to talk about that later, and also we'll discuss the way forward. As for the discovery of particular germ strain, ESBL. Yes, I'll ask Dr. Sid to supplement, but let me tell members here that under the chairmanship of the Secretary for Food and Health, there's a committee on drug resistance germs, because drug resistance is getting more and more serious. On the question of test report, I'll defer to Dr. Sid. Well, I have read the same report, but there's no further information available to me. The test is on a local chicken supply, and the test is about a particular type of gene. And the gene may lead to the drug resistance.
Now, as for whether such virus was found or whether it's just a possibility due to the presence of the gene, but as of now, it cannot be ascertained from the documents. So there is just a possibility of drug resistance. Now, on the antibody issue, now it's been placed on our agenda, and we have invited the administration to respond. And they said that the expert panel requires some time, and I have talked to Professor Yun Kwok Yong. They said that their next expert meeting will be in March, and by that time there will be we can have a further discussion on the consumer report. And some professors said that is 70 or 80%, so drug resistance. So we can have this discussion in the future. And now it's my turn to ask. I'd like to ask first. Now, in Guangzhou City, now recently 30% of the markets have been contaminated by avian flu. So that's a principal reason why they, of their own accord, stopped exporting chicken to Hong Kong. Maybe they were afraid that the chicken were not up to standard and might be culled locally. So there are two problems. First, in order to protect Hong Kong, perhaps Hong Kong can increase the number of live chicken raised locally so that we can be self-sufficient, because we have no control over the spread of the virus on the mainland. So perhaps we can permanently terminate imports of live chicken from Hong Kong, and we can increase the aid to local farms to raise chicken for local consumption, and the AFCD can monitor the prevention and control measures. And secondly, on the vaccines, now there may be needs for new vaccines as the situation requires, and there is now the bivalent R6+R8 vaccine. Now this is developed as a result of research in Harbin. Now the farms in Guangzhou or other nearby Chinese farms, are they also using the R6+R8 vaccine? If so, why is it that they seem to have lost control? I will try to answer the first question, and then Dr. Sid can supplement on the second. Now, the AI risk is growing around the world, so we are spending a lot of resources for gatekeeping. There are now no live chicken being imported from the mainland, even though it's not due to our initiative. At the same time, we are conducting a study by consultants to see whether we need to have a supply of live chicken in the long run. So at this time, we haven't had any special consideration. We want to wait till the completion of the consultant report in the next few months. So this is the situation at present. The Permanent Secretary, Mr. Wong, I'd like to supplement. Professor Chen has told us about the basic situation. We will listen to the public's views on the consultant report before deciding on the future of live chicken in the future. We don't have any established position. Now, in the document, we pointed out that there are now 1.3 million live chicken capacity in Hong Kong, but the capacity is not fully utilized. So I think we don't need to increase the capacity at this point. Dr. Sid, now you mentioned the situation in Guangzhou and Guangdong. Now, mainly it's H7N9. Now the R6 plus R8 vaccine, now that's mainly targeted at H5. Now, to our knowledge, there's no mandatory vaccination for H7 vaccine. So, therefore, the virus has spread upon any outbreak. Now, to my understanding, the R6 plus R8 vaccination is mandatory on the mainland. Now, different types of poultry may not be may not all, not all of them may be AI proof once vaccinated, but now the local chicken output hasn't reached the upper limit yet. Now, is the local chicken farm industry able to supply the needs of local people? Now, taking 2016, local farms provided 4 million live chicken to the local market. There hasn't been any significant large movements in the price of chicken, except during particular seasons, festivals of the year. So there has been no shortage. It has been quite stable. Usually it's about 10,000 chicken per day. Now, any more questions for the first round? If not, we can have a second round, Ho Chen Yin. 3 minutes. I'd just like to respond to the chairperson's question. Now, we think that the local demand has been suppressed or under pressure because in part due to the media. Now, the live chicken outlets, they are not evenly located throughout the territory. Now, I know the government is still very stringent in its position, but I think we need to have a live chicken capability in Hong Kong. Now, the Undersecretary seems to be saying that we are waiting the consultant report, and people might take this to mean that the chicken will be culled, and there will be no more need for live chicken outlets. I want the government to spell it out clearly that it's not that's not the government's stance. Chicken have been culled around the world. We have stayed clear of that over the years. So I think we should try to value this and try to preserve this. Mr. Ho is right. We don't have an established position. We want to read the consultant report first, and then we hope that there will be public consultation on that report. so that we can get a better picture. I hope the government consultant reports should be free of any established stance and shouldn't be affected by any preference by any CE candidates. There should be no CE should have any influence on this. No. Well, I think the agricultural and fishery sector would be very receptive to any candidates who supports live chicken in Hong Kong. The public's reaction to this issue might be entirely different from that of the consultants. So what will you do if there is a departure in public opinion from the consultants' conclusions? Well, we don't have an established stance. The consultant's report is not out yet, but the government has a policy of supporting the poultry industry. Now, we have to end the discussion on this item now. Members are concerned about this issue and about the relocation of the provisional chicken outlets, and then there is the antibody resistance issue. And then item number 5, the food surveillance program 2016. So we invite the other officials to join us. There is a document. It's again Professor Chen. Perhaps you can briefly highlight the issue with your PowerPoint, is it? Thank you. Now, today I'd like to report to you the food surveillance program by the CFS in 2016. We make sure that the food sold is according to legal requirements and suitable for human consumption. We take samples at the import, wholesale and retail level, and we take samples to and conduct analysis. The CFS takes into account past the monitoring results, the food incidents locally and abroad, and the results of the analysis to adjust its policies. The CFS in 2016 conducted the program, which showed that the overall passing rate is high, it has stayed high over recent years. And for foods that have been found problematic, the CFS has taken risk control measures, and the CFS will continue to maintain a high level of monitoring and also education and publicity efforts. And now I invite the CFS to inform us about the principal outcomes. It's Dr. Wong. Thank you. Now, due to the limited time, please speak into the mic. Because time is limited, I will try to be very quick. Now, we report on the food surveillance program in 2016.
As the Undersecretary has said, we monitor food for sale to make sure that they comply with legal requirements and are fit for human consumption. We take samples from retailers, and we adopt a risk-based principle. In determining the type of samples to be collected and the frequency
of testing, and we also report to the expert committee on food safety on the results for the previous year and the work plan for the future. Under the food surveillance program, apart from the general surveys, we also have specific and thematic checks. If an unsatisfactory sample is discovered, we'll immediately issue a press release. We also have test result publish. As for the thematic test and test on festive food samples, we would announce the results ahead of the related festivals or seasons. We have taken, for example, in 2016, 65,500 food samples, not counting the samples of food imported from Japan. So 65,500, not counting samples of food imported from Japan. That's 9 per 1,000 people in Hong Kong. It's higher than overseas rates. There were 152 unsatisfactory samples. The overall satisfaction rate was 99.8%. Let me talk about the findings. For example, pesticide residue in vegetables and fruits. We have tested 24,400 samples, and 45 samples were found to be unsatisfactory. Unsatisfactory rate was less than 0.2%. According to the pesticide residues in food regulation, exceedance of the relevant limits doesn't mean that there will be a health risk. There will be immediate adverse health effects. So those samples with unsatisfactory residue levels will not result in immediate adverse health effects. As regards preservatives in fresh meats, we collected about 700 fresh meat samples in 2016. 10 samples were found to contain sulfur dioxide, but there will be no adverse health effects if the food is consumed in the up to the normal level. We have notified the traders in question to ask them to make improvements. In 2016, we collected 1,500 aquatic food samples to test for the veterinary drug residues. 14 samples were unsatisfactory, 12 were fishy samples. Then there was 7 eel samples, 2 spotted scat samples, and 2 tin fried day samples, and 1 threat fin sample. We have done some tracing and also taken further samples for testing. Frozen confections and meal products. For meal products and frozen confections imported into Hong Kong for the first time, we would conduct tests of the first assignments before they are allowed to be marketed. 5 samples from 2 consignments and 1 consignment of frozen confections were found to have exceeded some the bacterial count indicators or colony counts or coliform organisms have exceeded the statutory standards. While these samples were found to have unsatisfactory hygienic conditions, it did not imply that the sample would pose direct adverse health effects. We have notified the authorities of the exporting places for follow-up action. The product in question have been suspended from import into Hong Kong until we are satisfied with the remedial action taken by the importers or manufacturers.
And for frozen confections samples, we took 13, 12 and it's satisfactory. Samples were found. For local cases, we've asked the manufacturers concerned to suspend the production line for follow-up cleansing and disinfection and to improve the production process to ensure that their products comply with the hygiene standards. And we also step up surveillance of such food items. Now let me turn to radiation testing on food imported from Japan. As I've said, in 2016, we took 73,700 samples on top of the 65,500 items for testing under the general program. 73,700 samples of food imported from Japan were tested. All of them were satisfactory. In a small number of cases, the radioactivity levels were found to be on the high side, but these did not exceed the guideline level set by Codex. We'll take effective and sweet risk-based actions when problematic or unsatisfactory samples are detected. Mr. Han Chiang, Mr. Chen Mi Tam, Mr. Stephen Holt, and I myself would like to raise questions. Any other member who would like to do the same? If that's the case, so 4 minutes for each member for questions and answers, because we still have one more item. Please manage time carefully. Ms. Han Chiang, I hope the CFS can be more proactive in responding to the food-related concerns. For example, the fake rate incident, speedy tests were conducted and tell people that it was not really the case. You know, of course, there's no fake rice, but when the rumors are circulating, people would maybe unduly alarmed. So I hope the CFS will be instructed to do something about rumors. They should be more proactive to clarify the situation. And turning back to the food imported from Japan in the wake of the Fukushima earthquake, according to a news report, our foreign ministry in the mainland that the reactor number 2 in the Fukushima the plant has reached its highest level, and people are reminded to be careful about radioactivity levels there. And according to BBC, there are some food concerns. According to the Japanese Ministry on Agriculture and Forestry, after the March 11th earthquake, there's been a significant reduction in the level of exports. Many countries have stopped importation of their produce. So Hong Kong has become the major destination of the exports. We are number one. We rank number one in terms of importation of such food. And you know, the mainland has banned the importation, and they are now trying to get Taiwan to import Fukushima prefecture food. Taiwan is unwilling to do that. They only allow prefectures in the neighboring prefectures to be imported. But we are very generous. We only prohibit meal products, frozen concessions, but we allow aquatic products to be imported. You talk about the radioactivity levels as low, But there should be no radioactive activity detected. So please check whether Hong Kong has become the major destination of export for such products from Japan. Undersecretary, concerning the regulation of food imported from Japan, we have we would continue to ban the importation of meal products and frozen confections from the five prefectures. As for the meat and aquatic products, they must be certified. They must have a health certificate before they can such products can be imported. And we would test each and every consignment. All the tests turn out to be satisfactory. As for whether other countries are importing such food items, we are not the same as other countries. Compared with Australia, New Zealand, and Canada, they have cancelled the importation restriction. And Singapore also allowed a limited level of importation from Fukushima. So we are more stringent than Taiwan and other countries. Mainland, Korea, and Hong Kong are still implementing some strict importation restriction measures. Ms. Jiang was asking whether we are more relaxed than Taiwan and the mainland. So these products are coming to Hong Kong now. Could you please give us some figures? I want to get some information from the Japanese ministry. And the major export destination for the Fukushima products. Which markets are on the top of the list? And so how many people are working in the radioactivity testing center? I'll provide the answers in writing. Well, if you have more questions, please leave some time for answers, members. Well, we have high expectations on the performance of the CFS because we rely on you for food safety. So please conduct more tests. For example, there should be tests on dioxin or on hairy crabs. I'm in favor of carrying out tests on various harmful substances, but you must tell the source country as regards what will be tested so that everyone will be competing on the same level playing field. And I'm talking about food imported from Japan, not just from Fukushima, because at present only five prefectures are on the restrictive list. But there have been cases whereby the food produced in Fukushima or from the five affected prefectures pose as food produced elsewhere. Have you tested radioactivity levels of food items imported from these five prefectures? I'll say something and then I'll ask my colleagues at CFS to supplement. For the food items imported through air, we test each and every assignment.
As for other imports, there's also a new approach right now. Dr. Choi? Now, as the Undersecretary said, our ban is in respect of certain food items from the five prefectures, including Fukushima. And for some food items, we require a radiation certificate. As for other food imports from Japan, we have a checking mechanism. As Dr. Wong said, last year for food from Japan, we tested over 70,000 batches. So we sample check the all the food items from Japan for radiation to make sure that they are safe. Now, Mr. Tam said that they went to other parts of Japan and then to Hong Kong. Now, we will nevertheless test for radiation to see whether it exceeds the limit. This approach has been adopted since the Fukushima incident. Now, the Undersecretary said all the food imported by air from Japan, irrespective of the type of food, would be tested for radiation. Is that right? Can you confirm that? It's actually food from Japan, even though it's by sea. So, irrespective of origin, as long as it's from Japan. Also, food bought on the internet, you said that you tested 4,000 samples. Now, you test a total of 70,000 samples, several percent. Now, food sales on the internet, how large is that a share instead of total Hong Kong retail food? CFS, please. At the moment, we do not have such statistics. Why 4,000 were tested? We assess the risk and test accordingly. Now, is there a scientific formula? No. We take into account a basket of factors. For instance, we have food surveillance and we search certain internet sites to see whether the food items are sold, and we also take note of reports of food poisoning and complaints. Now, you see the number of companies on the internet, but you don't know how much each sells. 4,000 is okay. Is it reasonable? How large is that of the total retail volume on the internet? What share, what percentage is that? We hope that the CFS can provide a written document to inform us. On the risk assessment criteria for your food sampling. Yes, we can do that. Now, one more point. Now, we take into account a number of factors. The retail volume is also considered. So, please spell out the basket of factors. Which are the principal factors and which are secondary, because we want to know about the criteria. So we will provide a supplementary document. Next, Mr. Ho Kai-ming, three questions. First, on internet sales. Now, I appreciate that the CFS has discovered the problematic sandwich sample. Do you search local websites mainly? Because the internet is free from geographical boundaries. Now you see some popular items sold on the internet, and then you take the initiative to check them. Now the market is huge and you can't test all of them. Now if some food standards are different on the mainland, then would you remind the public? For instance, influenza medicine, they might be very popular in Japan, but some of the ingredients are not allowed in Hong Kong. So would you remind the public about that? And also about radiation. Now, the Chinese consulate issued a notice yesterday. Now, Dr. Ma, now, is the radiation detected indicative of the impact on the human body? Now, if perhaps the radiation has affected the genes in the food so that it has mutated, even though there is no longer any radiation. Now, in 2016, the Food and Environmental Hygiene Department, around about this time last year, introduced some new requirements because the internet market was growing. So right now, if certain foods are to be sold on the internet, licenses or permits have to be obtained from the FHD, and there are requirements for such permits. There have to be legitimate sources, and there has to be proof that there is no interference or cross infection during transportation. There must be suitable temperature for chilled confections, and the certificate number has to be shown on the internet, and we also educate the public about the risk. Now, as of up to 16th of January 2017, the FHD issued totally 173 permits since, that is the cumulative figure since June last year. Dr. Choi? On whether we would assess the food sold on foreign internet sites. Now, I'd like to explain. Now, the FHD does the food surveillance. We have also done follow-up work. When the food is not suitable for human consumption, we take the appropriate law enforcement action. Now, there is the problem of jurisdiction, so we focus on the internet sales within Hong Kong jurisdiction. So we take the sample for testing. If the sample doesn't meet the legal requirements, we can take the law enforcement action. Now, on radiation, now if there's radiation in the food, the radiation directly affects the human being. Now, the member is concerned that due to gene mutation, people might be affected. Now, we haven't seen any such case yet that there is impact on the future generations, even though there is no longer any radiation. Now, you mean that the vegetable has already mutated as a result of radiation. Now, we haven't seen any such case yet. We are concerned about the direct impact on health from the radiation in the food consumed. Chang Chi-chun, I'd like to follow up on internet sales. Now, according to the document, the FEHD issued totally 163 permits, and then you follow up by inspections and the follow up, and you undertake prosecutions. There are said to be 26 prosecutions, and the Consumer Council has issued a report done at the end of last year. It said that it looked at 36 websites that already obtained permits. There are no uniform standards. Some websites didn't show the required information, and some of the information is incomplete, and the consumer is unable to get the full information. So after the permit is issued, do you follow up? Do you check whether the work is done and the information is disclosed on the site? No, because the Consumer Council did point out that the standards are deficient in some cases. And now, will you also provide clear definitions so that the industry can follow them? Now, in the prosecution and inspection process, are there still cases where the businesses are not clear about the requirements? Perhaps Mr. Li, Assistant Director FEHD. Now, we have been issuing these internet permits for about a year. Now, before we undertake this arrangement, we talked to the industry on how information can be provided on the websites. And so we have heard the views of the public, of the industry. Now, for instance, different types of food are sold and different permits are required, so not all the information can be shown on the front page. So when we issue the permits, when we make this arrangement, we allow the industry to make a commercial decision on the listing of such information. And the Consumer Council report indicates that the information is not exhibited in the same way in every case. But we do look at how the information is displayed, and we will talk to the industry so that the information is clear to the consumer, because that is the purpose of the arrangement, so that the public can be assured that they are buying the food from a safe source. So we will review this arrangement and talk further to the public. Now, the 26 prosecutions, maybe they sell a dozen types of food and they just applied for permits for several types, or they didn't apply at all. For the 26 prosecutions in 2016, now, these are cases of contravention. Now, we browse on the internet, we discover that some internet sales were without permits, so we successfully prosecuted them. So they never applied, right? On the 7 or 8 cases where the information is not appropriately provided, which the Consumer Council uncovered, now they have now corrected the for the and provided the information correctly. Now, for the five prefectures, we ban certain food items, but the food safety regulations stipulate the disclosure of the sources. And there's a recent media report that at an Aeon store in Quarry Bay, now they have an exhibition of products from Japan, from a certain Japanese location. Very few people know that that location is actually within Fukushima Prefecture.
They are not talking about the prefecture, but the name of a place. You mentioned in the law that the place of the origin will have to be mentioned, but the place is not a specific about the name of the prefecture, the country, or whatever. So when the importer imports food, they know the consumer would be concerned about food from Fukushima. So they mentioned a place in the Fukushima prefecture. So is there a loophole? The consumer has the right to know from which prefecture of Japan does the food come from. So are you going to review the law? But the CFS will be saying something about the issue. We are talking about packaged food from Japan and the relevant restrictions and measures. CFS. Oh, there's no specific requirement on the labeling of the packet. The labeling requirement on the packet is the same for all food imported from the earthquake. We are testing Japanese food all along. We know people are concerned about the nuclear incidents in Fukushima. So we are not sure, because there's no requirement for the prefecture to be named, and we have a prohibition order against five prefectures, but they will just talk about Aizu, which is a part of a place in Fukushima, and they will not know that it's from Fukushima. The prohibition or the restriction is on a certain types of food items. If it's a prepackaged food item, then there's no special restriction. But under the surveillance program, from the we'll be monitoring the imports and items on sale in the retail outlets. Maybe for prepackaged food or fresh food and vegetables, the importer should be required to specify the place of origin, i.e. the prefecture, so as not to mislead the consumer. We ask the CFS to look into the current rules and regulations. But there have been some suggestions to deal with certain issues, such as a fake rice. You have tested, carry out some chemical analysis, and the so-called fake rice is found to be genuine rice. Would like to know how the tests are conducted, what did you set out to try to find, and what are the findings? Can the CFS upload the test reports to inform the public with regard to the chemical test that you have conducted. Instead of telling people that it's okay or not okay, or it's genuine rice, not fake rice. Can you do the same in respect of pesticide, the residue test, and also the test for the dioxin or in hairy crabs? Can you upload all your test reports for public information? For the CFS can supplement. The follow-up action will take various forms. For example, we have to stop the importation as source, and there's also the need to communicate with the public. The CFS has been trying to inform the public through an easy to understand approach. Yes, your press releases would inform the public of the findings, but now people are more knowledgeable and they would like to know the details. For example, the contents of your test report, how the tests were conducted and for what purposes. Some people may be able to digest such detailed information. Those who would like to get simple answers can refer to your press releases. We'll ask the CFS to look into the channels for communicating risks. We'd like to get the reports on the fake rice scares and other tests as well. CFS, well, you have done what you have done. We just want the reports on the fake rice incident. The CFS has conducted tests in accordance with the food safety indicators, such as aflatoxin, heavy metals, and we have announced the results straight away. Well, we're not going to ask you to give us the details of the tests. I just want you to upload the information. We have already set out all the test results and what tests have been conducted. Whether it's a fake rice or genuine rice, it's the job of the C&E department. All right, we would like the government to follow up on this request. Three members have since joined us after I've drawn a line. So everyone will be given 2 minutes. Mr. Lau Kok Fan, and then Ms. Tanya Chan. You're doing this for the first round? 3 minutes? Oh, you have asked all the questions that I wanted to ask. So, Mr. Lau Kok Fan, and then Dr. Kwok Ka Kay, I want to ask a question about food safety of food items sold on the internet. It's becoming more popular. We're not talking about online shops. Online shops would apply for a permit. But there are seasonal sales programs. For example, during the Chinese New Year, they will sell tunic cakes and chocolate before the Valentine's Day. And you're not taking a lot of samples on such online food items. And is the registration process very complicated? Because if it's streamlined, then more would be willing to get registered. I think the use of internet to sell food is going to be more and more popular. Undersecretary, thank you, Mr. Lau. For seasonal food surveillance program, we cover items sold through the internet. As for the second item, I'll defer to my colleague from the CFS. Well, we have introduced the online shop license system. In order, we want to make it easy to comply by online shops. The application is not complicated. They will have to tell us the address, the business registrations, certificate number, the origin, the source of the source country, and the relevant certificates. From the time we receive the application to the point of inspection of office, the whole process will take fewer than 30 days to complete. In the past year, we have received 200 odd applications. As at the 31st of applications, we have issued 150 licenses. 40 odd are being processed. Some have received after last year. And some of them already hold other licenses. There will be no need to have a further license. And some are selling the full items not subject to the new licensing requirements. And the applicants have been duly informed. The entire application process is simple and straightforward. In September last year, there was a case of aflatoxin at 7.48. But we have a less stringent requirement level. Aflatoxin B1, Macau cover 17 types, EU 19 types. But we only cover two, the peanuts and peanut derived food items. So we are much more relaxed about this, much more relaxed than Macau and EU. We have been telling people that Hong Kong is a gourmet's paradise, but if people know what's covered by our system, they will be alarmed. And we have many food items imported through Qianhai under the surveillance program. Can you provide us with breakdown figures covering the samples taken from imported assignments from Qianhai? And this website, which is not very attractive, which is not user-friendly at all. If you want to do public education, well, you should not follow the usual pattern adopted by government departments. Because if you want to attract users, servers of the internet, you should try to engage people with better creativity. Undersecretary, with regard to the different food standards, I want to talk about aflatoxin. First of all, we follow international standards. When there are no international standards, we would set the relevant limits based on local circumstances. Our CFS to talk about aflatoxin. With regard to the Macau incident, after we received the report from Macau, we immediately took action. We checked, we took some samples of mooncakes, the same mooncakes, 9 of them, for testing. And we found that the aflatoxin levels were lower than that found in Macau. And Dr. Kwok is saying that in terms of classification and the standards,
are different from other places. CFS colleagues are now looking into international standards to see if our laws are outdated, which we may require updating. We will come back to consult you. So you're not just talking about aflatoxin. There are other things to test. We'll look at the food class category and also the hazards, food hazards, and then international standards. Turning to the Shanghai, since we enter into that agreement the year before last, there's been no food importation based on that Shanghai arrangement.
We do have a document, Mr. Kuo can refer to that. On the third question, on internet sales, we thank Dr. Kuo for his comment. We will look at that to see whether the website can be made more user-friendly. Now, your examination reports, maybe you can put them on the internet. The speaker is not speaking through the mic. Now, how to make it more user-friendly, we will take into account Mr. Kwok's views. Now, I have an opinion. Now, I listened to the follow-up to you on the follow-up action by the CFS. I didn't hear you undertaking or intending to undertake any prosecution. Now, is there any figure that you can provide? We do have the numbers here, but it's not provided in the document. Perhaps you can provide a written document, because we are short of time. Now, on the breakdown, whether it's the pesticides or the sulfur dioxides or dioxins, the number of prosecutions and the outcomes. So we thank the CFS and the FEHD, and we need to go to the next item. Now, we have to discuss implementation of the nutrition labeling scheme since we are now behind schedule. I exercise my chairperson's discretion to extend the meeting by 15 minutes. We hope we can cover this item. Now, will the government officials join us and the Undersecretary please take us through the document? Now, this is about the implementation of the nutrition labeling scheme. Now, in June 2016, the scheme is in full implementation. It covers prepackaged food, nutrition labels, the composition and labeling of baby formulae and prepackaged food, and the CFS has adopted a risk-based approach and monitored high-risk retail outlets. As of the end of 2016, the CFS checked about 45,000 prepackaged food items for the nutrient claims, nutrition labeling, and the CFS also checked 447 formulae, follow-up formulae, and prepackaged food items, and those that compliance rate is over 99%, and the CFS also undertakes publicity and education to help the public make good use of the scheme. Are there any questions from members? Hong Kai Ming, anyone else? If not, 4 minutes including answer. Now, on baby infant formulae, 33 nutrients have to be included. Now, our hospitals are encouraging breastfeeding. Now, the 33 nutrients, are they already very inclusive? Or are we discovering more nutrients that are good for the infant and which is in human milk? And the document says that we have a small volume exemption scheme. If it's under 30,000 units per year, you can apply. Now, there are 77,000 applications per year, and half is from Japan. Is it that this is a loophole that is being exploited? Because this might be how some Japanese vendors sell their products at shopping malls. Now 57% Japan and 9% is Hong Kong, so there's a big difference. Now on the 33 nutrients, now the infant formulae, nutrient labeling and composition, now all this is in accordance with international standards. We had reference to Codex at the time we drew up the legislation. Now on small volume exemptions, perhaps the CFS can inform us. We do have certain standards. Dr. Choi? Now for this exemption scheme, please speak into the mic. This scheme only applies to nutrition labeling. They have to meet general labeling requirements as well. The small volume exemption only applies to nutrition labeling, and if they want to enjoy this exemption, they have to apply to us. And certain requirements have to be met. For instance, there cannot be any nutrient claims. There can be no nutrition claim on the label. Nutrition claim, that means if they claim to be high in a certain nutrient. That's right. If on the label they say that they are high in calcium, then they don't qualify. And also, if they specify the calcium content, that is also not allowed. Now there are quite a large number of infringements, and there have been prosecutions. Now, what is the penalty if the prosecution is successful? The CFS? We do have the figures. Is it mostly a fine? Yes. What's the usual amount? the fine is from $800 to $6,000. For the successful prosecutions, well, how many successful prosecutions are there? 47 infringements in respect of nutrition claims on nutrition label infringements for prepackaged food. And now, is the penalty sufficiently deterrent? Now, the highest fine is $50,000 and there can be imprisonment. Now, we certainly will follow up if there is sufficient evidence. The DOJ, after seeking the DOJ's opinion, we will certainly prosecute. Now, the penalty decision, whether it's the upper limit or less, now we all know Hong Kong is a common law jurisdiction. So the penalty is ultimately decided by the court after hearing from both sides. Now, we mentioned the case of this location in the Fukushima prefecture. That is from a place called Aizu in Fukushima prefecture. Now they can choose to disclose the location as whether it's a town or city or prefecture. Now you have to help the consumer. The consumer should have the right to not consume food from Fukushima Prefecture, but if you don't require the importer to state the whether it's from a certain prefecture, then the consumer will be unaware. Now, the Audit Commission in 2011 November, they issued a report number 11. They talked about the food labeling and it made several suggestions improving the food safety inspection, including visual and chemical inspection, and in identifying the nutrient for testing, there should be more risk-based approach, and also there should be disclosure of the upper limit, and the also there should be suitable follow-up action, including surprise checks, providing guidelines and training for CFS personnel, and also to ensure that prosecutions are followed up, there's follow-up work after prosecution. Now, since the 2011 audit report, which areas of these which of these areas have been followed up by you? Now, as I understand it, the CFS had regard to this report, and the CFS accepts the recommendations. The audit report recommendations have been acted upon by us.
Dr. Coca K, we have been implementing 1 plus 7 for a long time. Remember when we talk about this, the government did promise us to conduct further reviews because that's not the ultimate objective. Because it was 1 plus 9 or 1 plus 11 when the government consulted us. And now the labeling system has been around for some years. I don't see major difficulties caused because these items have to comply with rules outside Hong Kong, for example, EU, and they're requiring more than 1 plus 7. So the first question is when is the government going to review this 1 plus 7 labeling requirement? And previously, because of the need to offer some compromise arrangements for importers. And also the label is so small in some cases, you have to use a magnifying glass to see the information, especially if you are an elderly person. So the label is outdated and the information is not educational enough. It will say there's a high salt, then you have to tell people the relevant threshold limits, for example, the information on energy or calories. There's no information to advise the consumer apart from the label. Well, I don't understand why the government stops at that, because you have to tell people not just the information of nutrients but also the implications of certain nutrition levels. What have we improved in terms of people's awareness? Have you conducted any survey on people's awareness or the adoption of health practices in the light of the nutrition labeling scheme? Well, for the infant formulate and follow-up formulate, we have just implemented the requirements on the follow-up formulate and prepackaged food for infants and young children recently. As for whether the label is too small or the print is too fine, well, we provide us this guidance note concerning the font size to be used and so on. After the guidance note has been published, the CFS has not discovered cases which are really unsatisfactory. Turning to public education, yes, the nutrition labeling scheme represents only the first step. In 2013 and 2014, we launched some public education programs to advise the public on how to understand the information on the label and also what those nutrients mean. We have launched programs to educate the general public and also the students. We all know that this 1 plus 7 scheme is just a step leading to further objectives. So I would like to know when more will be done
And also, have you assessed the effectiveness of this labeling system? But you have only offered us some general answers. We'll talk to the CFS concerning how the 1+7 labeling system is doing, and to see whether there should be a review and how to go about it. So we promise you to look into this. And then secondly, I'll ask CFS to respond to Dr. Kwok's question about whether any survey or study has been conducted to look into, to ascertain people's awareness of the labeling scheme. Well, the CFS has engaged a consultant to carry out some studies. In 2010, there was one to compare with what it was like in 2008. It was found that for those who had purchased prepackaged food, they would be referring to the nutrition labeling nutrition labels are more often, and there's a slight improvement in awareness according to that survey. So while the awareness is improving, we have also adopted other programs to educate the public. But the label provides certain information, and we need to the education sectors to inform people on how to make the best use of the nutrition label and to make informed choices for their own health. Well, for 1+7, the trans fat is one of them, one of the seven. We all know that trans fat, if consumed excessively, will lead to the rise of bad cholesterol in our body, and there are health risks. And the WHO has advised that we should reduce the trans fat level as far as possible. Trans fat can be found in margarine products or the cakes, and also we should advise people through the labeling to make it easier for the public to understand. Or I can ask the CFS call representative to say something about the work on the trans fats. I'm certain that there are certain public education measures, but you are, Madam Chair, you're talking about the label. Yes, people may not know that if they consume the trans fat to a certain or exceed a certain level, there may be a health risk. So maybe there should be a label telling people to be aware of the risks associated with trans fat if you consume more than a packet of this product or something like that. Can there be further enhancement to the label system? To answer this question, we have to look at people's dietary habits. We eat a different foods, and the amount consumed is different, and different people may adopt different dietary habits, and we should advise people not to consume certain items more cautiously. For example, you should stay away as far as possible from food with trans fat, but there's no specific level imposed. Let's say for this margarine product or this baked cake with trans fat, people should refrain from eating too much of it. There's no standard so far adopted by WHO. We'd adopt the public education approach. But how can you go about educating the public in respect of trans fat? Well, we would make use of the food pyramid approach to advise people to observe certain dietary choices. If we want people to reduce the intake of certain nutrients, for example, sugar and salt, we want to reduce the intake. And sometimes we can do something with the manufacturers, the producers. So if they can reduce the contents of less desirable nutrients or contents, then we can achieve something. In 2012, there's a survey on trans fats in food products. And we have noted that the intake levels have been on the decline. Yes, you have got guidelines for the industry, but how many people in the industry are following your advice? Well, you know, the guidelines are not legally binding. So how many of them in the industry are following your advice and how many are not? I hope through sample tests and other means you should try to find out the current situation. Yes, the CFS conducts regular surveys and we'll be able to know more about the big picture through such surveys. So we have been brief on the work of the CFS and also the how the nutrition labeling scheme is working. I hope you will look into the way forward over and above the nutrition labeling scheme, and that is whether the restaurants can provide a certain information which carries risk levels of different nutrients on their menus so that the consumer would be able to make a choice based on such risk information. We have learned that there are certain recommendations from experts. So in terms of food safety or in terms of nutrients of food as well as related risk factors, can you look into ways and means to provide more information? Madam Chair, you're talking about the overall food risk or other things? Well, if I have a raw oyster, the risk factor is of course much lower than consuming a cooked chicken fillet. If I choose a dish on this menu, I would like to know whether it has a high level of risk or a low level of risk. This is being practiced in other countries. All right, I think time's up. I would like to thank all the representatives from the CFS and the Food and Health Bureau. So to all of you, happy Valentine's Day.